Hi, everyone. Good morning. It's a real pleasure to be here today and to tell you a bit about what we do. But today we're doing something a little bit different. My co-founder Jim and I decided we should add a little bit of our learnings to share with people in iGEM who will be starting companies over the coming years. So you want to start a biotech company. Did you invent something that you want to exploit? Do you believe that you have freedom to operate? Do you know who the customer is? And do you have people believing you? Those are the basic questions you need to answer before you even start your business. So in the case of Colorific, we're very much a problem looking for a solution rather than a solution looking for a problem. Jim and I were working on biosensors to use it for detection of pollution in water when we became aware of how big an impact the textile industry, and specifically dyeing that you see at the bottom, has on the environment. Our sensor was based on microbes that changed color if the water wasn't safe to drink. And so we decided, wouldn't it be great if we could change the color of the fabric rather than measure how much pollution it's making? And the industry's coming under a lot of regulatory stress, not just consumers asking for more sustainability, but governments demanding and enforcing it. So the way we positioned ourselves is really as the company that's putting microbes and materials together for the first time at scale. Ooh. And the way we positioned our mission is in providing sustainability using biology, but transforming industrial dyeing using SynBio into something that's better for the environment, better for people, and still makes money. The reality is, if there is no financial sustainability to your solution, it's not going to have impact. No one's going to actually conduct that activity over time, and it's a great idea that will stay an idea. So in order to get there, you're going to need to spend some time understanding your business and your business model. There are great tools like the Business Model Canvas to help you navigate the different services, customers, inputs that you need to buy, etc. You need to be able to get on top of how much money you actually need in order to get your business going. And without that type of planning, you won't get there. So the key thing to remember is, even if it's obvious to you, it may not be obvious to a non-tech sector specific investor, may not be obvious to somebody who's joining your company. So mapping everything out so that it's really simple, really obvious, is going to make a big difference to your communication strategy, which is really key to getting your idea from an idea into reality. So this brings us to product market fit, okay? Do you need to know, does your product work? Does it replace something? Does it work well? How well does it work? Can you convince people to want it? Because one of the first mistakes that we made as a company is when we started the company, we went, okay, we have technology, it works. Now we need to get investment. But the reality is you need to get customers first and investors second, because investors are going to ask you, who's going to be your customer? How do I know that they're going to buy from you? So you need to start working on that first. So the way it panned out for us is we find colors in nature. Instead of extracting the pigments and colorants, we take the DNA code of how they're made, produce our microorganisms, and in our case, they're going to be made on customer sites. So we're doing fermentations in dye houses around Europe today. We harvest everything from the bioreactors, so the culture, the biomass, the pigments, anything else that's produced, and it goes directly into the dyeing machines. There, the microbes get in contact with the fabric, start transferring, fixing the pigments and dyes directly on. So our process is fairly straightforward. We do everything at body temperature, a brief temperature spike to inactivate the biology, and then it goes through two washes, one with detergent, which is great at taking out carbohydrates, lipids, and proteins, basically your biomass, and the pigment stays. Then we do a rinse to remove residual detergent, and the product is ready. Depending on what type of dye machine you're using, it'll either work for fabric, garment, yarn, and even print, which is our latest development. And I should point out that my shirt is also done this way. So we started the company because we saw an opportunity to create a big environmental impact. And measuring in the same dye machine, dyeing the same material to the same color with biology versus chemistry, you see how big an impact that actually makes. So this is a direct like-for-like comparison, and I should point out the product that we're dyeing here is 52% recycled recycled cotton, 48% recycled polyester. So cotton poly is the most prevalent material on the world, made in the order of several hundred thousands of tons a year. So one of the things that you will need to contend with when starting a company is identifying what are the regulations and standards that apply to you. If you don't, you can't communicate to the customer certainty that they can market the product, and you're opening yourself up to liability, because failing to meet these can literally kill your company instantly, right? It can kill companies that are already set up. Startups just need one wrong move to end the journey. In our case, it's the textile industry. So we teamed up with a leading certification body, Ecotex, developed a standardized testing protocol to go in line with everything the industry does to ensure that we're not causing harm to human health or the environment or anyone else along the way. All of our strains don't just go through quality testing for rub fastness, light fastness, perspiration, everything you want out of clothes. But we also test for cytotoxicity, skin contact, dermatitis, allergenicity, everything that comes with new chemistry, and all in order to avoid that liability aspect. So when it comes to production, you really have to consider a few questions. Who's going to be making the product? Is it you, or are you outsourcing it? Are you making the whole product or just an ingredient in the product? Because there's then that needs to slot into the next player in making that final product. And if it's not you, can they make it? What guarantees do they have? Is it if a batch fails, you pay for it anyway? Right? All of those things will matter in determining your costing and ultimately your value to your customer. In our case, we have two customers. Well, we'd like to call one of them a partner and the other a customer. The brand buys the end product from a mill. The mill gets a service from a dye house, and we sell an ingredient to the dye house. But if we just did that, we don't get visibility with the brands because the brands don't work with the dye house. So we had to settle on this two-tier customer approach where we partner with the mill who provides the product offering to the brand, and we sell ingredients and hardware to the dye house to run the process. So speaking of hardware, this is one of those problems that you don't want to solve that you end up having to solve. Scaling up in SynBio and biotech in general is hard and expensive. Initially, we just wanted to be providing the technology and the strains, but each customer would go and look for their own hardware. Each one would come with a different machine, different size, different spec, and that means that our team would have to solve different problems for every customer. And that's going to kill your scaling faster than anything else will. So we decided standardize the hardware, sell it to the customer, right? Own the problem, sell the solution. So we have a few improvements on the hardware to make it better to work in environments like dye houses. We're talking about very dirty environments, lots of particles in the air. Right now, fermentation is pretty much locked into industrial fermentation, meaning GMP environment, big fermenters, you need to make a plant and everything. We're actually applying these in dye houses today without air filtration. And since we're talking about scale, it's worth showing this working, actually, at this point. So we're showing here some garment dye on the top right, print, some fabric, yarn, and more fabric. I'll draw your attention to this fabric here. So that's cotton, 50% recycled, 50% organic. And the great thing about the tech is it works on lots of materials. So that's now nylon polyamide coming out of the machine. Both of those products meeting all of the market spec and all of the safety specs as well. We started our first launches end of 2021, really micro things with some brands. That escalated from H&M to Bengaya and the latest Volbeck. We're now in production for several others as well. This is the growth history of the company. So we started the company in 2016, got our first funding in 2018. That was roughly $2.5 million. Then we started growing the company. We were 4 people at the time. We grew to 17 people. You need to raise more cash to keep growing even faster. We raised a Series A convertible, got a few grants to keep things running. Again, keep in mind this was COVID. The financial markets were all over the place, and getting investors to commit is difficult when that happens. And then we went on to start implementing on customer sites, getting product out. We got our Series B, so we got some more serious capital to grow the team. We then grew up to about 100 people. We're working across 5 countries now, 2 in Europe, 3 elsewhere. And we are going into much more serious scale now. So one of the things that I get asked a lot by people who are trying to start their company is, how does valuation work, right? It's this red herring, because there is no formula that anyone can use to accurately determine value of something that's in the future. You're balancing in the very beginning, you're going only off what's in the future. As you continue, investors will be looking more at the present and less at the future of the company. So you need to keep them engaged, keep showing real-term progress, revenue, customers, etc., not just future promise. The other thing about your valuation is, the investor, on the other hand, does have a formula on their end, but not as to how much you're worth, as to how much they need to own of what you have, okay? So you need to consider, how much do you need to raise, what the valuation of that raise is gonna be, and you have to consider this point that the investor's gonna want upward of 15% of your company. At every funding round, they will want something along those lines. Whether you give it to them or not is a different matter. Your deal could be so good they'll accept less, but that's more or less where they're starting from. And then the last thing, and this is something I see a lot, is companies comparing themselves either to their competitors or to other players in the field. And this can come back to bite you. If that company in 6 months goes bust, your investors are gonna come saying, hey, how is that not gonna happen to you? How are you different? And you come under a lot more scrutiny. So for on our end, you saw where we are today. This is how we market about the future, looking at different products that we can get into, where we can improve the core technology to provide more value to the customer and get more sales. Our company is now based across 4 sites, 3 in the UK, 1 in Portugal for distribution into Europe. This is another challenge that I think most of you will not have to face, a country removing itself from a union and then overcoming all the logistical challenges that come with that. A list of our investors and partners. We have a mix of strategic ones, meaning ones that could be customers. We have ones that are sector specific, like sustainability, such as Sagana Impact. We have ones that are in biotech specifically. So try to find a mix of investors that include strategic ones, financial ones, and then sector-specific ones as well. That is the best mix you can actually get. And then finally, as I mentioned, we are working hard on scaling, getting more beautiful products out there, and getting to batch sizes of several tons of dyed fabric now. Lots of press, which again will help you get that attention from investors. And finally, okay, I wanted to cover one thing that I personally get asked a lot. And that is, what is it like being a CEO? What's the difficulties? Is it like you expect? And the key things I will say is, it takes much longer than you expect. Everything takes longer than you plan. So plan for it taking longer than you're planning. You're gonna have to repeat yourself a lot, not just to different audiences, but to the same audience, and especially to your team and your investors. You cannot lose patience, and you have to really make things clear. And the key one is, you're at the bottom of the totem pole. Even though you're at the top of the organogram, everybody's problems are your problems and not the other way around. And if you lose sight of that, you will lose your team very quickly. They'll stop believing in you. Investors often don't like technical founders. So you are researchers. Do your research. Read the Companies Act, how to run a company. Read MBA textbooks. You might not appreciate everything that's in there, but it'll all be useful to you, and it will help people trust what you're saying even more. And that's it. Thank you so much.